Hello, everybody, and welcome back to Seed Story Cup 5. We are starting with a new group. My name is Nimsh, and I'm here with Powder and Purple joining me on the couch. And Purple, I want to officially welcome you back to Seed Story Cup 5. I want to welcome you back to Europe as well, because you've been in the U.S. for the longest time, right?
A couple months.
Yeah, so how was your cat?
How's my cat? He's a pain in the ass, but he's adorable.
Okay.
So it's kind of okay.
All right. Did you bring it in with you, or is it still living with you?
I did not bring the cat.
Wait, did you just leave the cat in Farbat's apartment?
It's his cat. It's his girlfriend's cat.
Oh, okay. That's fine then. And Powder, how is your cat doing?
I don't have a cat.
Maybe you should buy one.
I'm not a cat person.
Okay.
I will buy you a cat.
No, please don't.
We should really buy a cat for Powder.
Please.
You'll actually find out they're adorable.
Yeah, I'm sure they're adorable, but I don't want to deal with that, the clawing and pooping and... I'm fine without anything.
Hey, claw is only 2 damage. You can deal with that.
Okay. Chop.
All right. So this match that we have in front of us, here at Lineup Guys, you can get accustomed with them. It's Terrence versus Thijs. So Terrence, who finished in the final of DreamHack Austin, the second place, and then Thijs, double European champion. Terrence also had a good run at DreamHack Summer. Unfortunately, didn't make it to top 8 or top 16, but still, he is a contender. Kind of EU versus NA, and obviously EU better than NA, right?
Always.
I'm NA, so...
You are kind of like... You're an EU team. You're Games Origin.
I'm also an ex-America's champion.
Yeah, I know. Just like you
conquered
them. How
does that make me European?
You conquered them and you came to Europe to find new challengers, right?
It's too easy on the NA. Too easy.
Too easy. Okay.
Which team are you, by the way? Like Horus or Anubis?
The blue one.
Oh, damn it. You're my team.
I'm not so familiar with my Egyptian gods.
You know, not yet at least. All right. Thijs versus Terran starts right now.
And we get to see a Hunter.
This is just a weird first match. So Rogue and Hunter are just not prominent picks currently in the meta.
Yeah, but this is...
Especially in this tournament.
Yeah.
And they both led off with the weird pick.
I told you that he might play Hunter because he banned Shaman.
Yeah, they both banned Shaman. So it's a kind of... It makes a little bit more sense why they're playing these two decks that we haven't seen before, because I'm pretty sure everyone banned Warrior or Warlock so far that I've seen at least.
Yep.
And if you play these two, you don't really want to play against Shaman. So.
Yeah, and it's refreshing to see those classes that we haven't seen in the previous group. Like, nobody played those classes in the previous group, right?
I don't think so. I haven't seen any of them so far, which is nice.
Yeah. And this matchup favors Rogue. Would you guys agree? Or is the new like hybrid version of Hunter actually making it 50-50?
We can't really see what Terrence's list actually is, but the way I prefer to play this matchup as a Hunter is if you have Freezing Trap, you just play a Freezing Trap, and you protect Freezing Trap until you play Caldwell. And then you kill them with Caldwell.
Yeah. A possible conceal.
So, you see Terrence went ahead and kept the bow. I might have kept the deadly shot, because there's a lot of minions that have more than 3 health. Yeah. So,
I think it depends a lot on what top end the Hunter is running. For instance, some people cut out high main to play Savannah Tiger.
Yeah, if you double Tiger in this matchup, it's absolutely disgusting.
Yeah.
If you play double Tiger, you're actually favored in this matchup,
yeah,
for sure.
Probably.
Because instead of your turn 6 being 6 mana, get sapped, conceived, it's Houndmaster,
always deal 5.
Hit him for 9.
That also.
Yeah, it's definitely much better. And how Hunter has to win this matchup, he just needs to go face. It's not like you want to control the board and anything else. This is a race. And Rogue overall seems to be a bit better in the race. As you mentioned, Cold Blood, basically.
Yeah, Cold Blood is just better kill command. Awkward hand for Thijs here. The 2 3 is actually really good in this matchup. You never want to play a 2 health minion here. Even if there's not coin SI, it's just backstab, eviscerate, uncomboed eviscerate. The 3 health minion just never dies here.
Yep.
Unless you want to coin deadly poison, and then you gave up both your activators for eviscerate as your follow-up for the animal companion. So,
if you're Thijs, you definitely wanted to see a 3-2 here, then you would have the perfect start.
Yep.
Now you kind of have to think what I want to do. The SI is still fine. You still develop something and make it so that you can always kill it next turn, but you still waste the coin, which is kind of awkward. So I think I agree with this just hero powering, just not doing anything.
Instead of being a 3-2 here, the Flame Juggler is actually probably going to end up pushing 5.
Yeah.
Which is very nice. And 5 is a lot, given your hands 6 damage with the bow, 2 quick shots, that's 12, and a kill command, potentially 17. So if Terrence can win in a few hero powers, Thijs is actually just dead already.
What? So fast it's turn 3?
Ah, yeah.
I mean, the
start
thing
getting
is, like, Tyus's hand is really weird because he has two cold bloods.
Yep.
And you really want the board before those becomes become relevant. And there's really no way he can get the board back with the hand he has.
Well, yeah, but like it can improve pretty fast. Like, let's say he gets a Tomb Pillager this turn, and that's not a Tomb Pillager, but if he gets the minions...
Tyus also has all his damage, but Tyus needs one of his minions to stick, which is tricky right now. The Drake might end up sticking. It'll be something that doesn't die to the bow. Playing the SI7 here, I think, is fine. It's actually just, you have to think of it as deal three, heal three.
Just tank damage also, right? So SI makes sense, especially because you cannot just pass this turn, and possibly next turn we'll be coining out Azure Drake to see what you get.
You could also, I guess, play Blood Mage just to get a different card. Yep. It'll increase your odds of hitting a backstab, which would go well with the Drake for the 4-drop in Hunter, which is either the 3-3 dude or Houndmaster.
I mean, if you're Tyus, I think you're very, very happy that Terrence didn't play a minion on turn 3. If he played, like, an Animal Companion, it would have been much more awkward here because, I mean, he could have, yeah, Avist, maybe double Avist, but it's still, like, now, yeah, he has a bow at 6 damage, but most of the time, that bow is just going to... like, clear the minions.
I do like this. Build your own Magma Rager.
Yep.
pretty good against Hunter.
Yep.
Yeah, just either taking damage or losing a minion, or just have forcing a quick shot from hand.
Let's see how aggressively Terrence wants to play this.
Now with the huge dote, you can actually quick shot this.
Yeah, you have the option of quick shotting it. But if you quick shot, you're actually giving up damage because you're missing your hero power. So you take. If you were feeling aggressive, you could have been like, okay, I'll take 5 to deal 2. Which is a reasonable line.
But still, it being a race, would you really want to do that? There's Edwin Van Cleef now. Not much potential to make it really big, but I think you still want to have the 6-6, right? You can go...
You can also clear the board of the SI7.
Yeah,
I really like playing just SI Avis. You're already down to... 22.
The thing is, like, then you have a 3-3 on the board, which just dies to the board, so it doesn't really get you anywhere.
Protects 3 damage.
Yeah. It's choosing, like, a proactive line rather than a reactive line.
Yeah, your and other
that, that really depends are, on your play style.
I mean, your other plays are kind of awkward because I can't really see him ever going coin Drake. But if he had backstab, maybe.
Coin Drake seems just wrong.
Yeah, I mean, you could go coin Edwin, or coin Avis Edwin, but the problem with that is that you really want to Avis the 2-3.
And not the 3-2.
Yeah, I mean, now he's going to Avis the 3-2, which is...
What I like about making the Edwin play is if the Edwin 6th round, you can actually go ahead and cold blood that next turn.
Yeah, it's pretty big.
You can start racing even better. And also, you still have a side for the next turn.
Well, there's Caldwell. So the play should probably just be Quick Shot and Kill Command.
To not take damage.
I mean, the way he played it last turn, I could see him going Quick Shot, Kill Command, because he didn't want to take 5 damage. But here, he needs to start hero powering. Like, he has had 2 chances now, so why wouldn't you just take your 6? You're really far ahead still.
I think with the Call of the Wild draw, you're kind of, the context of your hand changed a lot, and now you're more oriented towards getting the Call of the Wild. And just keeping the bow developed actually just gives you a bit of extra mana, so to speak.
I mean, it's kind of the same, though.
Besides that, take 6. 6 is a lot.
Yeah, but against Rogue, it's not really that bad because, you know, he's like never going to be able to like play a minion and it's actually going to stick that easily.
You are also ahead in the race now, so he was able to make the decision because he went face with the rest of the damage.
Ooh. Ooh, that's a lot of damage.
Yeah, that's a lot of damage here.
There's 14 damage in hand.
Another Kill Command.
Yeah, if I was Terrence, I'd be wondering, I'm like, why didn't I just point all of this upstairs?
I mean, now it's kind of awkward because you really want to play... Like, you never want to trade here because you have such awkward trades.
Yeah, the trade would be the Quick Shot and the Kill Command going into it.
Yeah, so they just have Master Hero Power and go face with everything else, like just leaving.
That's also
a minion
really
on the board.
Greedy.
So scary though. It's a rogue. Like, you've seen one Cobalt maybe, but still, like, another Cobalt and conceal, and you're in a terrible position.
I think the Houndmaster and the Quick Shot's pretty reasonable. You haven't seen a single backstab yet, so As soon as, like, you lose on the spot as soon as that's drawn. Like,
if Terrence is keeping track, Tice kept the SI from the mulligan.
You have a pretty good clue at the SI.
He knows it's like, it can't be that many cards. Like, it's not backstab ever.
Yeah, backstab
like, like, it could be prep in some scenarios, but prep doesn't seem that good to me to keep against the Hunter.
I think so it's like if it was prep, the Edwin would have been a 10-10.
Yeah. Okay, that's true. So it's like prep. Almost always an SI here.
So Deadly Poison is not bad overall.
You don't want to take 4.
Yeah, you definitely don't want to take 4. That's a quarter of your health.
The Avis seems really nice
you
here.
You definitely want to be getting that Pillager on the board anyway. So yeah, the Pillager and the Avis seems to make the most sense.
I kind of liked playing the like Deadly Poison SI, deal 5 to face this turn.
If you do 5, then next turn you have 6, so you're doing 11. You're 3 off of doing that. And you already used the Cold Blood, so you actually you actually have no outs because you already used the Cold Blood. Had you still had a Cold Blood remaining in your deck, that line actually it did make sense.
Yeah, overall, like Deadly Poison is extra damage there.
The Deadly Poison is a good card in the matchup. It's 4 damage for 1 mana, which is...
But saving the SI here really worked out, though. You get a free kill on the 3-2.
I actually think you go Gadget here.
Now with the Conceal?
You have 3 cards for backstab, right?
Yeah.
So, you also have 3 cards for
prep. The chance is so high. What could you be on? Like 12 cards or something? No, it's more than 50.
Like even if he didn't get the backstab,
he's actually drawn 0 so far, so he's 10 cards in right now.
Yeah, so it's 50.
It's a really decent action here.
And worst comes to worst, you use Deadly Poison and kill his guy.
There's a backstab. Yeah, really good spot for Thais. Just taking an advantage, even though there is Call of the Wild.
There was a lot of merit in holding Deadly Poison to just start off your next turn. Because if you don't have a...
Ooh, we play Skulker.
Skulker kills Huffer. Skulker SI and just a Deadly Poison clears this.
He drew Savannah.
Yeah, Thais actually has a really nice clear here.
And Skulker, by the way, is being added to Rogue recently. It's like the lack of Blade Flurry, you have to play something that is an AoE as well.
So I would always play Skulker SI here. You've seen all the burst from Terrence. Like, there's no
you haven't way you seen Unleashed down, so.
Yeah, but still, he doesn't kill you with Unleashed because he has no more kill commands, no more quick shots.
Yeah, actually, you're absolutely right. It's just 3 damage.
Yeah. It's like double Unleash is like the most he could have, and that's...
So he just picked up one of the cards that I really don't like in this deck, but it's been like... It's come back in popularity.
Well,
it just got popular recently, the one of Squire in the deck. What do you guys think about it?
I like it versus Zoo, for sure. And versus some decks, sometimes there is no answer to an Argent Squire Cold Blood. If you want to be aggressive early.
I think it makes a lot of sense in the deck. I don't know if it should be in there, but it makes a lot of sense where you're a combo deck that has like combo, the word combo, where the one-off is like the one mana is
the
really
one mana,
important.
Which doesn't depend on you having a dagger up too.
Yeah. Sometimes you want to know the cards.
And like Nim said, Argent Squire into Cold Blood is pretty good.
So lethal here, Leroy Cold Blood's 10. You hit the gadget into the Misha. Three trees. We'll see if Thais can spot this.
Oh man, this is a hard lethal, Thais.
One over lethal.
He got this.
Leroy. Jenkins.
Leroy Jenkins still alive in this meta game, and Thais is going to take this first game. So we talk about the balance a bit. Shaman banned on both sides.
Yep.
So this is not going to be last Shaman standing.
So there's a Warlock and a Warrior. Zoo has a pretty 50-50 matchup, and Reno Lock struggles a lot against Rogue, in my opinion.
In my opinion, Terrence has to be playing Reno. Like, you don't ban Shaman if you're playing Zoo.
Yeah.
There's no way.
Reno has a really rough matchup.
Against Rogue?
Yeah.
And
so that leaves you Warrior.
It depends a little bit on what deck you're playing, but yeah, it's like never favored for Reno. The Rogue, it just, like, Auctioneer Conceal is just so strong.
Like, Terrence was playing Reno at DreamHack Austin as well, so he said, like, this is one of his favorite decks.
Let's see if... it's like one of the defensive warriors, and this matchup is pretty polarized towards the Cthune Warrior, unless you go Gadget Coin Conceal,
push
30 over 2 turns.
Yeah.
And also, like, Cthune Warrior can sometimes just not work when you don't get the small Cthune buffs.
Yep.
And then you just sit on double Ancient Shieldbearer. And there's a 6-6 blind.
Yeah. And this pick's like super nice for Terrence as well, because Tice doesn't actually have information yet on what Terrence is actually playing. And that means you, like, even if it, he wasn't offered a gadget in his mulligan, but against a random warrior, if you keep gadget, you can probably die on turn 5.
Yeah, that's actually
just,
right.
You just got Alex Draws' championed on turn 2. And
yeah, most of the warriors they go face, which sounds weird, but this is the metagame we are living in.
Where a warrior can do anything.
Yeah.
Aggro you down, kill you in one shot, or take you to fatigue.
So Tice will be looking for the hints what warrior deck this is from Terrence. But at the moment, just an early start with Argent Squire makes sense as well. What do you guys think about Tice's hand at the moment?
Doesn't have Pillager, doesn't have Gadget, so it's fairly weak.
No Essice as well.
It has Teacher, but
it has a lot of potential. Just with the Squire on board, like, you actually doubled your amount of good draws. Or I guess you just increase them. You have, like, Pillager and Gadget you want to be seeing. But now you can, you also just want to be seeing this Cold Blood.
Yep.
And Terrence is just wondering if he should actually swing at this, because if that gets Cold-Blooded, he actually just loses.
Yeah. Well, it would be definitely tough to deal with a Cold-Blooded 1-1.
Do you ever play the Thalnos just to get the card draw?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
I guess why not, right?
You also kind of want to like, have more spells for Violet Teacher.
Kind of increases like the value out of the 3/3 on curve, but
yeah,
Doomcaller as well.
Yeah, so this list is like not the best of lists against Rogue, just a bit slower and less defensive than a list with say Bashes and a Revenge in it.
Yeah, but this is still kind of like the same schematic where you just want to play the Cthulhu minions, have Cthulhu at 10 attack at 7.
I would actually rather lead with the Teacher in this spot. I know it dies to Slam, but the Pillager also dies to Slam, but the Teacher doesn't die to Ghoul.
They both die to Disciple of Cthulhu, though.
You could also just not do anything this turn, which is like.
Yeah, but it seems not kind of awkward when you have such a good curve.
Yep. If you had Gadget in hand, I think there was a lot of merit in just passing.
You still don't know what you're
playing. Yeah, I mean, Double Coin is pretty strong.
Now you know.
Yeah, now you know which Cthulhu.
That is like a huge sign. Hey, I'm playing Cthulhu Warrior.
That'd be very interesting if
he
wasn't.
So he drew the Pillager and the guy. That's pretty nice. But he still doesn't have the best way to deal with this.
Yeah, usually that card really sucks against
Rogue. You can just hit backstab. Hit SI.
Yeah, that card usually dies to zero mana. But here it's actually a pain in the butt. Tice can't actually remove it. Besides running the Pillager into it.
And you still have to like run your 1-1 into it. So you're basically throwing your Divine Shield and...
I think that you should just play Violet Teacher and go phase for 6.
Really?
Your next turn Skulker anyway, so...
Okay.
It's going to die.
I guess if
you make the trade, I guess, then that doesn't force you to Skulker and you can Drake.
Yeah, I mean,
but Skulker's not a good card in the matchup, so you might as well cash in the value.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. The Skulker, like, I don't think you're ever going to get much better Skulker than this.
And you don't actually need to draw cards.
You have the Gadget,
Coin, Conceal. You don't want anything else.
Yep.
So saving the Drake, having Drake in your hand as an extra spell power dude to do things later is pretty nice.
So for now, it looks all right for Tyze, actually, and Terrence is still lacking the second Cthulhu buff to be able to...
Yeah. He's lacking the good cards like that you have against Rogue. Like he's doesn't have a Shield Slam.
Slam, Execute, Disciple of Cthulhu. Yeah, there's a... Like,
that's
a very
normally what
draw.
You mulligan for. You mulligan for your weapon because it's normally like the best card against their 3-drops.
One of the saving graces he does have going for him is that Tice actually has this Violet Teacher on board. And...
Makes it a bit of a
It just means when the Gadget Coin Conceal comes out, the Gadget's very likely to die in the brawl.
Yeah.
I think with the Gadget in hand, I think getting the second coin out is pretty good.
That backstab is quite nice.
Yeah, it makes it so that the Teacher won't die to the War Axe.
Yeah.
Because like, if you don't get backstab, you still have to kill Bran.
And accidentally, Tice is actually just playing around Harrison Jones.
Hasn't weaponed up the entire
game. Yeah, he just doesn't dagger all game.
Yeah, I mean, if he had like a 2-attack dagger, like, he would have definitely played Harrison Jones last turn.
Oh, man. So you just this shield block here and look
the
for
the worst part of all this is really Cthulhu is still not active.
Yep. Like,
and still not active. Thorison is not helping him much.
Although next turn he probably has the brawl anyways, but...
Yeah.
I mean, there's no way you don't go...
There's actually merit in just doing nothing here. If Eight of turns enough.
Like, if he wants to do nothing, I would have liked to just go Pillager pass just to, like, bait the brawl.
Yep.
It's still right a really good brawl.
Yeah, Pillager pass was definitely a better setup to play around brawl this turn.
Yeah.
But in Tice's defense on this one, it's just like, what are the odds that my opponent's turn is actually just, like, shield block pass? Like, that's just, like, real. You can make the best play against, like, someone who does absolutely nothing, but...
I mean, I really like this play. It's like you're thinking one step ahead here, going like he hasn't played a single card like in two turns that are good, so it's very likely that it has a brawl in hand.
Yeah.
And this makes the brawl really good without making it like super amazing because you still have your auctioneer in hand.
Yeah, you have a sick follow up with double coin.
And now even like Harrison wasn't doing much. You can draw the cards and then there's so much damage just staring you.
Yeah.
And
now on Harrison you go down. Oh, well, that's a.
Oh, that's a win for Terrence there.
Yeah, that was a really good play.
Yeah, but he still has, like, now Terrence used his first brawl, very unlikely to have the second, and Tyus can go Auctioneer. Can he go Auctioneer Edwin? No, he's one off. Auctioneer Edwin can conceal.
But your opponent doesn't have shield slams or executes. You can make that raid.
I kind of like not using the coins here.
I kind of like not playing conceal here.
Yeah, that seems so greedy.
I think you definitely have to read. Your opponent does not have execute or shield slam.
He could have shield slam. But I mean,
he
have two conceals. Why would you take the risk?
Because you make an 8-8.
But you can make like a sick Van Cleef next turn.
Yeah,
with,
that's for sure.
Like, I don't like him using this because there's like no way that... Okay, it's Ragnaros, but do people run Ragnaros in Cthulhu?
No, they don't.
So there's basically zero ways this Auctioneer gets dealt with, and you almost always want to play Van Cleef next turn. So you wasted 4/4 on this Van Cleef.
Yeah, it'll definitely be bigger than 8/8 next turn.
Yeah. And it could have been even bigger. I don't think it will matter, but...
So Tice played around Harrison Jones, but with like the copy of Deadly Poison, Zek really didn't like him poking with the dagger last turn.
All right, so this is a miracle turn for Tice, just drawing as many cards as possible and then getting a big Edwin and conceal.
Looks like he's
going upstairs. You can hit in and then backstab.
Just poke and backstab.
It's like SI Edwin.
It's looking like a pretty underwhelming turn, but...
I kind of don't like playing SI.
Yeah, because then Brawl is much better.
Yeah, it's like Brawl has a 30% chance of getting a 3-3 and you actually don't insta-win.
If you don't play SI, you float the mana, and that just kind of feels bad.
Yeah.
I think you play the SI for...
Yeah, I mean, you always play the SI, but I think he could have maybe sequenced his spells in a way where he didn't.
Well, he definitely didn't need to hit the bubble. He just took, like, 4.
Yeah.
I guess that doesn't actually matter, but...
I mean, he did one extra damage phase.
I think Tice is winning.
Definitely winning.
I think it's looking pretty good.
Guys, there is a Goldie update. We have Hotform winning versus Camelon on the secondary stream. And the status of points is Team Horus is winning 1,600 versus Team Anubis.
Which one am I again?
You're Horus. Like,
so you're winning.
The cool one. Team
you're
Mystic.
Winning.
Yeah.
I'm winning?
Yeah, we're winning.
Yes.
We're winning.
I'm losing.
Oh, you're on my team now?
I'm losing.
I'm on your team, dude.
I didn't know that.
I'm Anubis.
Oh, you're the last man out here.
You're the last Anubis here.
Damn.
Oh. What about those guys? Like, let's see what teams they are in.
So Tice is definitely Anubis.
Tice is Anubis, and then we have Terrence and Horus. So I guess, like, I'm rooting for Terrence now.
Yeah.
And we have Tice up 2-0. That's good for my team. I like it.
I don't like it. We should change it. Terrence.
He's gotten coin 3 times in a row with Rogue. That's also pretty good.
It's rigged.
that's why you play Rogue.
That's
to get the coin.
Good.
Hey, you fly Rogue so you can meme people with Edwin Van Cleef.
It feels good, man. Just having like a big Edwin crushing face.
The turn 2, 12-12 every game.
Perfect. I love it.
I mean, getting coin, like, you've gotten coin twice and you know you're up against... Oh, it's actually Sue. I would have...
Yeah. As Tice, this is actually a very hard mulligan.
You can never think this is Sue. Like,
you're definitely,
I would mulligan for
you're
Reno.
Definitely
you're 100%.
You keep backstab no matter what.
You can keep fun of knives. The matchup,
no,
you wouldn't keep Fan and Ice.
Oh, you don't know what to do.
Even at Zoo, you don't actually keep Fan and Ice. It's a like impaired.
Okay.
Because the ritual comes out on like turn 5, turn 6, right?
Right. So you want to have it late
and
game.
And if you're using it as removal early, like even if you're killing like Juggler, etc. with it, you're actually just opening up yourself up to Fan and Ice by casting it early.
Yeah.
So you actually want to draw later.
I mean, the question was if you keep Auctioneer or
yeah,
not.
Yeah, exactly. Against Reno, you really need it early. And against Zoo, you probably lose because you kept it.
Yeah. So he decided not to keep it, which will benefit him here.
And Sergeant Squire keep has just been working out.
Yeah, it's been good.
He's actually just going to be ahead on board against Darren's here.
Yeah, it's good.
Is there a reason
backstab
to bump?
Backstab hit is pretty good.
Was there a reason to bump? I'm not sure.
No.
Do you just backstab Cold Blood and get him?
Ooh, like, that's actually interesting.
Like, I'm used to, like, when I have an Argent Squire in my rogue, right?
Yeah.
I'm not going, my curve's not going to six.
Yeah.
So, my instinct is Cold Blood and get him.
I don't think so. I don't think it's the right play.
you get a clear kill here, and you can
you
deny it.
You get a clear.
Like, the thing is, like, sure, you're going to get in.
What if you get in 10?
You
though?
Might get an 8. That's the most you can get.
Yeah, you get 10.
Is it worth it to get an 8?
One damage. One mana 8.
Well, if you go for Cold Blood, there's also a chance for, like, Knife Juggler hitting you with the...
Yeah, he's going to get
you just saw a Knife Juggler.
He's going for this play.
I love it.
I don't like
get him.
Oh, it's 10. Yeah, it's not 8.
I thought you were counting the Cold Blood damage.
Yeah. No, in my head it was...
Yeah, because in your head you're actually playing against Aggro Paladin here.
Guys, the Jago comes.
Oh! Hey.
And looks like Terrence is not going to get beat up by the Zoo.
That's how you lose the game.
Had he just dagger last turn, you wouldn't have been as good of a spot. Like, the 1-1 would be dead now, right?
It's
so he would have been able to poke the Death Rattle minion here. It was bad either way.
The difference is, like, you wouldn't have done any damage face, and you would have a 1-2 weapon now.
Yep.
And also Cold Blood in your hand.
Yeah. But the Cold Blood is, like, never good. That's a good top deck.
That's a good gamble there.
That's perfect.
And backstab number 2. Prep would also be a very good draw here now.
Yeah, I mean, maybe you always go coin, Azure, and hope.
Yep.
You don't have any other plays.
If you pass, you're actually dead, so.
You want backstab.
Backstab or prep, right?
Prep's okay. Abyss
not yet.
Next turn.
Somewhat good news is, besides getting Gormoked.
That's a really good top deck.
I was going to say that Tice does actually have to trade into this Drake because of Spanice.
I was going to say
good news is he has to trade, but then there was a Gormok, so.
The only positive thing is that the knife hit the Azure Drake, so it took one less damage.
There is a prep, finally, but doesn't much.
Yeah, just the turn too late. Like, the fan last turn, you disabled that Gormok, you make the trades pretty awkward for Terrence.
Imagine if you had Skulker here, though. That would have been sick.
Skulker prep fan? That's a dream.
Yeah,
that's actually a clear.
Sometimes you actually beat Aggro Shaman doing that.
It's actually a clear.
Yeah.
No Skulker, though, so...
But now no Skulker.
Tough spot.
Yeah.
You can still rip backstab. You can rip backstab and maybe still be enough.
Yeah. Backstab's okay.
Or the second prep would have also probably been
good
enough.
You have to prep, I guess, Shadow Strike.
Is none of the fan remove more?
The fan removes...
2...
5.
It's
the same. It's actually worse. Because the juggle could go face.
Yeah. How does this work? Does he get the juggle here or not?
It depends on which one was played first, right?
I have no idea. Oh, there's that Skulker you're talking about.
Nope.
This time he doesn't get juggled. I feel like it's not consistent.
That's like a thing you probably should know, but I don't know.
Yeah, we should probably ask this guy's toast. He can make a video about it.
Yeah, 6-7 damage.
So is there any good card next turn? I guess the second fan would be pretty nice.
There's going to be an Imgang boss on board.
Oh, that's an Imgang boss. I thought it was a another councilman.
No, councilman Imgang boss.
Yeah, it's one of each.
Yeah, okay. So then, I mean,
I don't,
still okay, but...
I think you have
did
to...
Did he go face?
I think that...
Would you go going, face?
If you play Soulfire, maybe.
It's Azure Drake, so... It's probably better to deny this spell than...
I think you never lose if you trade. So
you can actually have a decent turn with Sap.
You can
Shadow Strike.
What if you just Shadow Strike a Vest, dagger up, set up for the Skulker? There's only 4 on board.
You can't
There's no mana.
Oh, I guess you just don't dagger, but...
But yeah, I mean, I guess the Abyss is better because you have Skulker.
Yeah, well, he's just going to play it again, right? All right, neither of those, just daggers. I would have rather seen him, like... I guess he can just sap Skulker most of the time next turn.
That's two damage, one more damage.
One more damage.
That Adler, might be one more damage.
Adler probably most of the time gets it in.
Is there a Stuntas Boar, Elven Archer? Oh, that's just...
Not one damage.
That's just like a... It's still one damage, but it's just going to be a little slower.
Anyway, yeah.
As he's at one, but, and the sap Skulker is going to leave him.
Why didn't he Abyss last turn? He would have cleared with Skulker here.
Yeah. Yeah.
Would he have taken...
He would have taken one instead of two, three. Or he's taken two instead of three.
Yeah,
he had two as well.
Attacked.
He'd have a bit more health and have a fourth three and been at two health and had a mighty dream.
Skulker.
Almost.
Yeah, there is this one damage just sitting there.
This possessed villager.
Shadow Beast.
I would have rather seen the Leper Gnome.
Yeah, Leper Gnome would deal two damage. True.
I haven't seen that card since he got nerfed.
So, Team Horus.
Space Hunter.
Look, Terrence is even wearing like a blue jersey to represent the Team Horus.
So he has.
He planned for this. He was told Egyptian theme. I'm wearing blue.
Yeah, absolutely.
The problem for Terrence here is that Tyus has Warrior. And Warrior is known to be the best counter to Zoo.
Yeah, but you can still win this matchup, and it's...
It depends on which Warrior it is.
I've heard this actually happens to other people sometimes, but sometimes Warrior doesn't have War Axe when you're playing Zoo.
Oh.
Sometimes that happens.
Not to Tice.
Not to Tice.
No.
Not to Tice.
Not to your double European champion. Come on.
So Tice is playing OTK.
That's how you win championships.
That is confirmed.
In theory, this matchup is super good for the Warrior because you have Pyromancer.
The combo.
You have Ravaging Ghouls.
Yeah. If you've ever actually imagined what Priest would look like if they had Fiery War Axe, it's actually kind of like this OTK deck where you have all the sweepers and a War Axe against Zoo.
Yep.
It's not bad.
So that's what Priest is missing.
Priest needs War Axe.
Yeah, War Axe.
Maybe we can get like a
Blizzard,
staff.
Please.
Like a 3-2
staff.
Staff.
Okay. And just instead of being Anduin, it can be Gandalf.
Or like a wand. Fiery Wand Axe.
Fiery Wand Axe.
Some weapon for the Priest to actually make it playable, because it's kind of sad that Priest doesn't see any play.
So do you keep the Knife Juggler here?
Did he keep the Argus?
No.
Okay.
Okay, I like this Morgan. I wouldn't
I got confused.
Well, whatever Warrior this is, you want to be as aggressive as possible.
Yeah, Tice 2 kept, right? One of those cards is War Axe.
No, I think Tice also was pretty slow at mulliganing. I don't know if you saw. I like this. Possessed first.
Yeah, Terrence
is pretty good.
I'm pretty sure Terrence has to read. There's a War Axe, so I think he caught wind of how many cards Tice kept. So.
Yep.
And it's also cool when we see the loot quarter. For Terrence, it will be a clear sign what deck this is.
Yeah,
it's
absolutely.
Like, Worgen deck.
It could be Enzoth Warrior. Enzoth Kafumer.
Come on, is it even played?
I play that deck. It's good.
It could be.
You just, instead of, in Cthulhu Warrior, actually, the idea is that there's too many 3-drops already. You already have 7 of them, and then you add an Acolyte, so you just have too many. So instead of having Acolyte, just play Luhoder. And then you already have Sylvanas in your deck, because Sylvanas is awesome. So then you play Enzoth.
You can possibly. I've seen some versions of that deck, but it was never popular, really.
No.
Where this deck, the Worgen combo, is actually super popular on ladder now.
Yeah, in the last few days. Terrence just had a sick read on Tice's hand. Like, he's just like, okay, you have War Axe, I know that. You kept two, you have War Axe, so I'm going to play all the stuff that War Axe doesn't do anything against.
Yeah. And this Wolf is actually really good.
Yep, behind a Voidwalker, it's actually going to push a lot of damage.
Yep.
Even though, like, Tice had War Axe, it was just not good because Terrence played around it.
So the big question is, will Terrence be able to make it still? There is a Ravaging Ghoul, there is no Pyromancer yet.
He's still at 30, so he's got some time.
You can just go War Axe. Loot Hoarder is pretty strong.
You can also just slam the Wolf. Then there's just no pressure on you.
Yeah.
It gives you a lot of time.
Slam War Axe, slam Loot Hoarder.
Makes sense, yeah.
Your deck is like pure draw anyways. So you're going to draw into draw, so.
Yep.
And you already have like Worgen and Charge, which are the one-offs. So you're looking for Faceless and Thorison.
Yeah, you're pretty far off from even thinking about lethal. Like, having those combo pieces in your hand early is not usually a good thing. You want to draw your combo pieces when it's lethal, not have them in your opening hand.
I mean, especially against a deck like Sue, right? You just want to clear the board. You just want to be alive for as long as possible.
Well, sometimes you win this matchup even without the combo.
Yeah, just because you can clear the board and leave one minion off.
Yeah, you just like clear the board, play Emperor, hit you for five.
Yeah.
You played Flame Imp and Dap. The Emperor's doing a lot of damage.
I agree with this play.
Yep.
It takes off a lot of potential damage.
And it sets up pretty nicely for, like, Ghoul and Loot Hoarder next turn. Yep. Even if DM King lost, leaves a 1-1 up.
Let's see what he can get off this Peddler.
I wonder if it's going to be double Peddler or Peddler or one drop.
No,
one drop.
I think you always go Peddler. At least the Voidwalker here.
Well, now you have two of them, so.
Yeah, I mean, it's just so strong. It just... Like, otherwise it just sets up for Ravaging Ghoul or any, like, Whirlwind play.
Yeah, usually you just want the War Axe to swing at your low attack minions to so it protects the high elf.
When I'm playing this matchup mostly from the Azul perspective, the big thing I like about the matchup is that there is no Brawl. So if you are able to set
Wild Pyromancer commanding shit, it's like the same thing.
So, like, Wild Pyromancer is like Brawl, but this is two cards, and you can try to play around Ravaging Ghoul.
Yep.
And then if you play around Ravaging Ghoul and they never drew Pyromancer, you have a chance to win this.
If they never draw Brawl, though, you also have a chance to win it.
Yeah, true.
I mean, I think this is one of the best draws you can have against a warrior. Going, like, a pretty resilient one drop into Imp King boss is, like, one of the ways you can actually win.
Yeah, one coin three is definitely, like, what you want to be doing against every warrior deck.
Yeah,
Playing the guys that don't die to Orex, it's awesome.
And no Pyromancer for Tice as well.
Not yet.
We don't exactly know which version Terrence is. That changes a lot.
Now he just wants to kind of... I mean,
I think
there's not much he has to do here. You just play the Loot Hoarder.
Yeah, you play the Loot Hoarder. You're looking for another spell so you can make Terrence Bible Thumb next turn.
I think you could have waited to do this until next turn, but...
It actually sets up for the Pyro pretty nicely, so it's pretty good. Right, because you just left a bunch of one health minions on board. It's just like a two-turn clear. If you loot hoarder, you have like a three-turn clean.
And you still have decent health as well.
Like, I don't know if that draw is good for Terrence, just because it like.
You have to play it though.
Yeah, of course.
Gormek is good. Gormek is good,
like,
because
if you get sweeped, like I mean, you're giving your opponent like Ghoul number two value and Pyro value.
Yeah, I mean, Tice's play is like always.
Indicative.
He always set up for this. So it's kind of awkward where you're like, you would have traded in your one things, but then I guess Gormek, like,
I think
just
he's
so good.
Gonna have to execute, so that means his Pyro's, like, gonna die. Oh, no, it doesn't die. But
it doesn't, the
Voidwalker will take care of it after, though.
Yeah.
Like, the big problem with this matchup for Zoo is when the Pyro, after this turn, like, fully clears and doesn't die.
Yeah.
Then you're in real trouble.
But it didn't, so...
So 1-1 Voidwalker that could.
Or a... Mortal Coil would be okay.
Yeah, absolutely. Keeping the extra minion for the wolf would be insane.
Now Terrence can also finally start life tapping.
No insta pick.
Do you guys think he's playing Doom Guards or Leroy?
Really hard to tell.
Yeah, there's. Gormek tends to go Sea Giant, I think.
At least once Sea Giant.
Yeah.
You can still play like.
And you don't usually don't play Doom Guard and Sea Giant.
I mean, Gormek is more of a personal call, I think. It's either like you play Gormek
or Dark
Iron Dwarf, so I don't think it matters that much.
Yeah.
Because most of the time you still play the same things. It's just that if you play Leroy, you have an extra space for a Sea Giant.
Terrence played his hand pretty aggressively without any life taps, which could be indicative of Doomguard over Leroy.
Yeah.
Because,
I mean,
dumping your hand for the Doomguard top deck is just generally how you play that kind of stuff.
I think he just played how his hand was.
Yeah.
I don't think there was any turn where we would have done anything different, like tried the life tap. Well, life tap is one of the stronger things against war, just because having the cards when, like, you can replenish your board when they clear. But he's been pretty fortunate in the way Tice has drawn his hand. He's drawn this whole combo, which is really bad.
Yeah, it's actually, it's...
Without Thorison.
It looks bad now, but when it'll be lethal, he'll be like, that was good.
Yeah, I mean, if he draws Thorison now, it's actually, like, a lot of damage.
Yeah, so it is Doomguard.
But the Doomguard is pretty good. Man.
I guess this is all going phase.
Yeah, at this point,
yeah,
you
there's
can.
No way you're clearing that 2-1.
Doomguard
feels bad
well.
Pitching the PO, actually.
Well, when you're playing this board
like that, I don't think you can.
That full combo's there, but you can't do much.
So he needs...
The old 13-mana combo in turn 8.
He needs two cards. He needs Whirlwind into Execute. I don't know how he's going to
I wonder if you're actually just going to like faceless the Doomguard here.
I mean, it makes a lot of sense.
You don't need the full combo to kill Zoo. Like, the full combo actually just does 60. So, I think you do this, kill the Voidwalker, pure Doomguard, kill the Wolf. Then there's only 7, right?
7.
You go to 11. So you're dead to PO number 2. Given you just saw, like, PO number 1 get discarded. I like playing that.
Yeah, that seems good.
Just make a 2-2.
Yeah.
It makes your potential, like, Acolyte of Pain a bit weaker, but...
Like, if you do this, you can even maybe play Rampage on your 5-5 so that it clears the Doomguard by itself.
Oh, you're not armoring up when you're doing that.
Yeah, but you're taking away extra 2 damage.
I don't think you need to Rampage this turn, because I don't think Terrence is trading his Doomguard for your Doomguard.
That is true. That makes sense. It seems like a very weird... Oh, it's just doing it on that one.
Actually, if...
I think it should be on that one.
You have 24 damage.
You don't want to clear the 2-2? With Inner
Edge? Oh, you're going to... Okay, you're going to do both. So that's 8. No extra damage.
Actually,
that was an interesting play, but that you have like combo in hand, so using the Inner Edge is like giving up so much.
Yeah, because like this is 24 damage in hand.
I mean, I don't play this deck at all. I haven't played it a single time in my life.
Is it 28?
It's 24 damage, right?
It's 4, 6, 8, 11. It's 22.
So you actually just won.
Yeah, Terrence is just dead here.
Yeah.
Nice deck.
Okay. So that's why you don't play.
22.
Yeah, that's definitely. It's,
I mean,
so the Worgen goes to
so
4.
That's
then
why
he's
you
at
trade.
6, 8, 11 is 22, and he has 7 on board, so it's 29.
So that's why you trade with the Doomguard.
Yeah. Oh man.
I mean, it's very unlikely that he has this, but you kind of guess because of the way he's been playing this game.
You were never going to win the game if you traded, and he had anything else.
I think so. Yeah.
If he had, if he doesn't have this combo and he just has like card draw. You lose.
You're right.
But you know he doesn't have like a whirlwind effect or something like that.
Yeah.
But guys,
it's hard to read.
Won the series.
Thais won.
Yeah, Thais won.
Thais won.
So you're pretty happy. Team Anubis, I guess.
Yes. Get some points.
Some points.
All right.
We needed them, so.
So like before Thais comes here, what do you guys think about the deck overall? This Worgen deck. Is it that good? Is it worth playing?
It's pretty busted. The fact that like that was turn 9, but it I played a bit of the mirror matchup. And usually one player just dies on turn 8. Making Demir really stupid, because who starts first usually wins.
I mean,
but,
it seems
really good
pretty
deck.
Strong.
What's up, Thais? Let me give you the spot.
No, you just stay here. Just
on,
like, go,
yeah.
You want some on the lap, Thais?
Yeah, have some space. That'll be nice.
All right, Thais. Congratulations. You won the first match versus Terran Zem. And why this Warrior? Did the Warrior like fit your lineup? Or
out of all the viable Warrior decks.
There are a lot of Warriors to pick. There are a lot of Warriors that... just are super top tier. It's just what fits the best in your strategy. And for my strategy, with covering the control classes already enough and banning mainly Shaman, I think it's a good deck to pick.
With that deck in your lineup, why are you actually banning Shaman and not like Warrior? Because C'Thun Warrior actually just runs you out of damage, right?
Yeah, but it, like here also the first match, I just don't know what he plays.
You have no information.
And
yeah.
I also wasn't really sure if he played Zul. I know him also as a Reno Lock player. So it was also a really hard guess, but I'm a little bit surprised that I actually thought it was more Reno. Also, ban-wise, it made also sense.
And then talking about his ban, like when he banned your Shaman, what did you think he exactly has in
I think he just won't like to ban Warlock. I didn't have Warlock, and that made the Shaman ban happen. I don't know. I think might have been... if he has this C'Thun Warrior, probably Shaman ban the Warrior. But, so it might still be the best ban to do there.
All right, so and we just started a second group, so you had some time to hang out with people and enjoy the event. How are you doing since Cap 5 so far?
Yeah, I really enjoy always participating at Seed Story. Like, you want to win here, you are playing here to do well at the tournament, but also everything besides, you will always have a good time here. And yeah, it's one of my favorite, for the players, this is one of the favorite tournaments to participate.
So Hearthstone still a game, but you have to just work in your bunny hopping game still, right?
Yeah, my bunny hopping. I also really sorry for Team Anubis.
Yeah,
I really.
I'm ashamed. I'm ashamed.
I said it already. Yeah, I really have to practice well. Then didn't really went my way, but I will come back stronger in bunny hopping.
All right. Well, you actually got 200 points for this win, because now Team Anubis won versus Horus, then it's Horus, so...
I said it! Hey!
Yeah, you guys are winning this round. This round you won, but next one...
I'll get you, Thais. I'll get you.
Powder, do you have any questions for Thais?
No, I was just really surprised when I saw that he had Zoo when he was playing against the Rogue. And you were sitting there thinking, I'm guessing you were thinking if you're going to keep the Auctioneer or not.
I have a really big question.
Such a hard time, but he mulliganed early, and I saw him keeping two cards. So that made me really think of, it might still be Zoo. Like, there are not many cards you keep against Rogue as a Reno. Yeah. Like, you look for your four drops, and there is then the Reno, you keep. And besides that, there is really little you keep, so I was really thinking, what will I keep as the Reno play? And I came at four cards.
Yep.
So I was like, the chances that he has two out of these four cards has to be low. And that was why it might have called still have been the Reno, but I was like, let's not risk it. Yep. And still questionable if I saw that played the Squire there, like that I went for the call, but I like the play.
He wanted to do it, I didn't want to do it.
Yeah,
so it was like,
but he also, like, one juggler was gone, so I knew it would contest his three drop even, and if he will go face, I could conceal it afterwards. So only the second juggler will punish me, but yeah, it was interesting. Luckily, I had still my OTK Warrior left for Zoo, but also went still really close.
Purple, I think,
is a big question. Why Rogue? And why no Warlock? Like,
I think, people either target Warlock or they ban it, so that's already a thing for me. But it just fits my lineup so well. I think Rogue is just not maybe tier 1, but tier 2 deck, but it benefits so much from if you ban Shaman.
Yeah,
The aggro Shaman at least. Midrange Shaman is a bit better, but so I was like, yeah, and I feel I can cover a lot with Rogue. Maybe not the best meta pick, but everything. I also practice the deck the most. I have some really cool techs into it that I think work really well against popular meta decks now.
Yeah, the Dark Iron Skulker and the Squire for the Zoo matchup.
Real good. But also like for the Token Druid. Like a lot of people play Token Druid, and you have no answer for like.
Yeah, you just blow out the.
Crazy,
blow out that turn.
I love the card.
Yeah, it works really well, and it worked for you as well. All right, guys. I just want to remind everyone that if you want to support Team Anubis or Team Horus, you can still tweet at us with hashtag Team Anubis and Team Horus. We'll have all those games and fun during the tournament as well. But maybe bunny hopping again, a rematch, or something else as well. And that will be it for this round. Good luck with the next round, Thais, and have some fun. I will leave you guys as well. And for you guys, we'll be back soon with some more Hearts in Action.